Hi, this is Julie Harland, and I'm your math gal. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where you could search for any of my videos organized by topic. This is part four of hyperbolas, and this one we are discussing hyperbolas centered at HK, and we state the standard form of a hyperbola centered at HK, and we do the following problem. Recall that the standard form of a hyperbola centered at the origin is one of these two things you see right here, x squared over a squared minus y squared over b squared equals 1, or where the sign in front of the y squared is positive, so it's y squared over b squared minus x squared over a squared equals 1. And it's easy to tell what the x-intercepts are for the first hyperbola and the y-intercepts for the second hyperbola and what the asymptotes are. And the general form means you're just going to multiply all of this out. There's one thing I did not make clear about this general form is that A and B must be different signs. So one's positive and one's negative. Okay, some people assume that means they're both positive, but remember, these are just constants, a, b, and c. So we're going to take this and now think, what would happen if it was not centered at the origin? And this is what happens. It looks very similar, except if we have a center HK, then instead of just an x squared or a y squared, we'll have an x minus h squared or a y minus k squared. And again, either the x squared is positive, the coefficient of the x squared is positive, or the coefficient of the y squared is positive. The slopes of the asymptotes will be the same. It'll be plus or minus b over a. Remember, b always goes with a y and a always goes with an x. But the actual equations, since they'll go through the center HK, will be this y minus k equals plus or minus ba. That's the slope. X minus h. That's sort of the form of a line. So the general form of a hyperbola now will have ax squared plus, and you could have capital letters, I just happen to put in lowercase letters. There's an extra one I put here, cxy. We aren't going to be doing any where we have an xy term, but there are parabolas that actually have xy terms. All the ones we're doing are going to be vertical or horizontal hyperbolas, so this. You won't see this term. In other words, c will be 0. All right, so let's try a problem. All right, so we're going to graph this parabola. Y minus 2 squared over 9 minus x plus 1 squared over 16 equals 1. And so notice that 9 is 3 squared and 16 is 4 squared. So if you want, you could rewrite those in that form. So you can see this is 3 squared and that's 4 squared. But let's go ahead and start with the center. Where's the center? We're asked to state the center anyway. So what will the center be? Well, if it's an x plus 1, that'll give us a negative 1 for the x coordinate. And y minus 2, that'll give us a 2 for the y coordinate. So there's our center. So we can go over here and negative 1, 2. We know that's the center of the parabola right, I'm sorry, of the hyperbola right here. Now we want to make our little box. This is going to be done the same way as if it was centered at the origin. So in the y direction, think of this as 3 squared. We're going to go up 3, 1, 2, 3, okay, and down 3. And those are going to be, oops, I went from the wrong place. Down 3 from the center here, which is right here. So those are the vertices. I should have asked for the vertices. So the vertices of this hyperbola are, let's see what that is. Well, I've got negative 1, 5, and I've got negative 1, negative 1. So those are our vertices. All right, now in the x direction, 16 is in the denominator, so that's 4 squared. So I'm going to go over 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then the other direction, 1, 2, 3, 4, Remember, we could just sort of make this little box to help us draw the asymptotes. So if we do this, our box should go right through. Those are our asymptotes. That line, again, I'm just sketching it. I know it's not exact. Okay, so there's our asymptotes. And since the coefficient of the y squared is positive, this is going to go up. So we just use the asymptotes as guides. Okay, same thing here. So that is how we graph it. Now we're just sketching it, right? Okay, now I found the center, I found the vertices. I'm asking for the equations of the asymptotes. There's two ways you can get it. You could actually just look at your graph and figure out what it is by trying to see where it goes through the y-axis here. I'm not sure that I drew it very accurately, so it isn't obvious to me what the y-intercepts are. So instead, let's do it this way. We know the asymptotes are going to be the form is instead of y equals plus or minus a over b, it's y minus 2 equals, we're going to have plus or minus. So we'll do first the plus, and what will it be? It's always the y over the x value, but remember that's the 3 over 4. So that's going to be one asymptote. And of course, that can be simplified or written in a different form. You could put it in slope-intercept form. And the other one is plus or minus 3/4. I'm sorry, minus 3/4 x plus 1. So these are the equations of the asymptotes. And if you wanted to put this in slope-intercept form, we could do that as well. So let's go ahead and just write that in intercept form, and you'll see why that was hard to figure out by looking at the graph, because you're going to have some fractions here. So let's say we wanted to put these in slope-intercept form. Here are two equations. The way I like to do it is to multiply both sides by the least common denominator, getting rid of the fraction. So on both of these, the least common denominator happens to be 4. So for the first one, I've got to remember to multiply 4 by this whole quantity on the left, so or by each term, however you want to think about that. That'll give me 4y minus 8. It will cancel with this 4, so I only have to do 3 times the x plus 1. So that'll give me 3x plus 3. And so then I would just add 8 to both sides, which is 11. And then I just divide by 4. Now, you don't have to do it the same way as I did it, but if you did write it in slope-intercept form, that's one of the equations of the asymptotes in slope-intercept form. Let's do the same thing over here. We'll have 4y minus 8. And now the 4 cancels, so we have a negative 3 times x plus 1. Make sure you distribute this negative 3 all the way through the parentheses. So it's a negative 3x minus 3. And again, I'm going to add 8 to both sides. So negative 3 plus 8 is 5. And then divide both sides by 4. So that will give you the other asymptote, which is y equals negative 3/4 x plus 5/4. So like I was saying, it was hard to see where it went through the y-axis from the picture, but these are the equations of the asymptotes in slope-intercept form. So let's see if that looks right. So one of them is y equals 3/4 x plus 11/4. So slope of 3/4, okay. But we've got a y-intercept of 11/4, and the other one has the y-intercept of 5/4. So let's see, 11/4 and 5/4. Let's check it out. 11/4. So, nope, that doesn't really look like it to me. Oh, yes, it does. There it is. 11, 4. So it's around, almost 3, right? So that's this first one in a slope of 3 fourths. The other one is 5 fourths, and that's this other one right here. I was looking up here. I want to look at where the asymptotes go through. So it does look like that would make sense, those two equations for the asymptotes. All right, let's do the last part, which was to write the equation in general form. All right, to write the equation in general form, what we want to do is multiply everything by the least common denominator to eliminate fractions. So let's begin with that. And let's see, that would be 9 times 16. Now, you could just write in and multiply everything by 9 times 16. That's actually 144, but it'll be easier when I distribute here. I'm going to multiply this first term, 9 times 16 times y minus t squared over 9, and it's easy to see the 9's canceling. Minus. Then we're going to have the 9 times 16 times the next term, and it's easy to see the 16's canceling. And then I have to multiply 9 times 16 times 1, which is just 144. Okay, so now what do I do? Well, I've got 16 times the quantity y minus t squared. I'm going to have to square that binomial, and that's y minus 2 times y minus 2, and I'm going to use the formula that if you, because of space, I'm not showing all the steps using the FOIL method, but we'll get 16 times y squared minus 4y plus 4. And then for the next one, I'm going to have to square x plus 1 before I multiply it by 9, and that's x squared plus 2x plus 1. Everybody remembers that middle term, right? Don't just write x squared plus 1 or y squared plus 4. If you need help on that, go back on multiplying polynomials, squaring polynomials. Okay, now we can distribute the 16. And distribute the negative 9. We're getting really close here. So we can either write the y squared or the x squared term first. I'm going to go ahead and just write the x squared term first. So it's negative 9x squared plus 16y squared. All right, next we're looking for the x term, which is the negative 18x. And then I'm looking for the y term, which is negative 64y. And let's see, I've got 64 minus 9. All right, so that's going to be, I think, 55. And I'm going to subtract 44 from both sides. So almost done. Negative 9x squared plus 16y squared minus 18x minus 64, and then I've got 55 minus 144. Let's see, so what's that? I have to do 144 minus 55, 89. So I have minus 89 equals 0. Now notice I have a minus sign in front of the x squared. If I multiplied everything by a negative 1, all the signs would change. Both of these are exactly the same hyperbola. So it's hard to tell when you only look at the equation in general form if it's a vertical or a horizontal hyperbola by the signs. You really can't tell because in one equation it looks like the minus signs in front of the x squared, and the next equation it looks like the minus signs in front of the y squared. You can't tell until you put it in the standard form which one it is. So that's important. So both of these are correct. The main thing that lets us know that it's a hyperbola is that the coefficients of the x squared and the y squared term have to be different signs. One must be positive and one must be negative. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com where you can view all of my videos which are organized by topic.